Hi everyone, in this video we'll talk about data types in C++. So let's get started. So in our C++ language we have built-in data type as well as user defined data type. So in this video we'll mainly focus on fundamental data type, and these remaining data type we'll talk about them in some upcoming lesson. So the other name of fundamental data type is also primitive type, right? So our language C++ provides different data types for integer, character, boolean, which can represent two value, either true or false, and then we have floating point numbers, right? And then void data type, which is valueless data type. So this particular data type is mostly used with functions. So in the upcoming lesson when we'll talk about function, so there we'll see that how can we use this particular data type. So now we shall see each of these data type one by one. So before talking about the integer data type, let us talk about first of all that what is the purpose of data type. So it determines the type of data that a variable can store. So what type of data your variable can store, that is determined by your data type. For example, if I write something like this, int n, so if n is the container, that is a variable, so what type of data this variable can store is determined by this keyword int. So that is the first point. Second thing is it allocates the required amount of bytes in order to store data. Now if you want to store data in memory, then the smallest unit that we can access in memory is byte. So most of the computer systems are byte addressable. That means they can read one byte at a time, right? So how many number of bytes your variable is going to occupy in main memory is again decided by your data type. And the third thing is that it tells you, or it also determines the set of operations that can be applied on a particular variable. So if you see, this variable is an integer variable, so we can apply all arithmetic operations with this mathematical data type because it can deal with numbers, right? Similarly, if you are having floating point data type, so we can apply arithmetic operations there as well, right? So your data type determines that what type of data your variable is going to store. Then it also tells you that how many number of bytes is going to be occupied by your variable. So actually the number of bytes that are required for a particular data type is actually compiler dependent, right? So it depends that your compiler is 32-bit compiler or 64-bit compiler. For example, if you talk about your 64-bit GCC compiler, then it occupies 4 byte for integer type. So let's talk about the integer data type now. C++ provides three different data types in order to use integral values. So let us see them one by one. First is your short. So let's give the variable name n1. Then the regular integer that we are using, int n2. So this is the most used data type in order to represent integral values. Then the next is your long, n3. So this can store larger numbers as compared to short and int. So let us initialize these three variables with 0. Now if you see this variable short n1, so this can store the smaller range value as compared to this int and long. So let us say if you want to store a limited range as compared to this int and long, then you can use this short data type, right? But if you want to store larger range of integral values as compared to short, then you can use this regular int. So generally this is the most used data type for integers. And if you want to store even larger range of values as compared to your short and int, then we can use long. So all these are actually integer data type. The only difference between them is that the number of bytes that are allocated for this data type. Now how can we determine that how many number of bytes are occupied by these variables? So for that, the C++ language provides something called size of operator. So what is the purpose of this operator? It gives the size of an object. That means your object can be your variable or any other data structure. So how many number of bytes it is occupying in the main memory is returned by your size of operator. So let's see how can we use this operator, right? So for that we'll write some cout statements. So we can see here size of short data type, or we can say size of n1 in bytes. So remember one thing, whatever number the size of operator will print on the screen, that is actually in bytes, right? So let us see that how many number of bytes this particular variable n1 is going to occupy in main memory. So for that we can use size of, and within this parenthesis we can just pass the variable name. So size of will calculate the total number of bytes and print on the screen, followed by new line. So let us save this. Now if you see, these lines are not actually the part of executable, so let us comment it out. So if I save the file and compile it, so g++ space data type dot cpp. So if my program doesn't contain any error, then we can proceed ahead, right? So since there is no error, it compiled successfully. So in order to execute it, I'll write /a.out. So if I hit enter, you can see that so n1 takes 2 bytes. So my compiler is actually 64-bit GCC compiler. So in my compiler, it occupies, right, the n1 variable whose data type is short, it occupies 2 bytes. Now let us see this int and long, how many number of bytes these are occupying, right? So if you see the size of n2 in bytes, then we can pass the variable n2. And if you want to see that the number of bytes that are allocated for long variable n3, then we can pass n3. So let us save and recompile it. So if I execute this, you can see that the size of n1 is 2 bytes and the size of n2 is 4 bytes, and then the size of n3 is 8 bytes. So you can see that the size of integer is between the size of short and size of long. So we can derive a relation between these three data types, that the size of short data type will always be less than or equal to the size of int data type, right? In turn, this size of normal int data type will be less than or equal to your size of long data type. So this is very important relation that you must keep in mind, right? So now if you observe one thing here, even if I write here, let's say short, and here int, and here let's say long, so what should be the output? Let us check. So if I recompile it and execute again, then it gives the same output. That means even if you pass the data type here, so it returns the number of bytes. So it tells you that how many number of bytes is going to be occupied in the main memory, right? So next we'll talk about more about these things. So let's see now, if we observe this variants of these data types for int, then we can have again two variety here. First is your signed and the other is unsigned. So what is the meaning of signed? That means your data type can store negative values, positive values including zero. But if you use this keyword unsigned, then we can use only positive numbers including zero. So this is the range of your short int, that is minus. So in case of signed value, right, we can have -32768 to +32767. So if this is the entire data area or your entire range for your short data type, then half of the area will be used to store your negative values and half of the area will be used to store your positive numbers including zero. But in case of unsigned, what is happening? We are using the entire memory area or entire area in order to store the positive values including zero. So by this figure, it clearly depicts the usage of short in case of your signed and the usage of unsigned in case of your short. And this is true for the remaining data type, that is your int or long. So similarly for int also, we have the variety of signed and unsigned, and these are the ranges that you can observe here very carefully. And same thing is for the long. So now let us see in more detail that how can we use this keywords actually, right? So if I go to my code, and if you observe one thing here, so let me erase this part because you already know now how to calculate the size. So if I write here let's say unsigned, right, if I write here unsigned short int, that means this particular variable n1 is capable of storing only positive numbers including 0. But if I write signed, then this particular variable n1 can store the range of short, that is from negative this to positive this, as you can see on the screen, right? So the same thing is for your int as well as long. Now if you do not write any of the keyword, that is your signed or unsigned, then by default C++ treats each and every integer data type as signed. That means even if you don't write here signed, C++ automatically assume that this particular data type, short, int, long, are signed. Now if you want to use only positive value, yes, there are some situations where we need to use positive values all the time. So in that case we can use the keyword unsigned. So please keep this in mind, right? So now let's see the range of data types. So first of all, let's focus on signed data type. So in signed data type, we will have the range from negative to positive values. So the minimum negative value that can be stored by your data type will be minus 2 to the power n minus 1. So this will be the least minimum value, or you can say the minimum value that can be stored by a signed data type. So it can be a signed short or int or long. So what is this n? So n is the number of bits. Now how can we calculate the number of bits? So if you observe, this n1 occupies 2 bytes, right? So if you know this, that 1 byte equals to 8 bits. So if you are having n bytes, then the total number of bits will be 8 into n, right? So since our short occupies 2 bytes, so the total number of bits that will be occupied by this variable n1 will be 2 into 8, that is 16 bits. That means the minimum value that this n1 can store is your 2 power 16 minus 1, that is minus 2 power 15. So if I open my calculator and calculate the value, 2 to the power 16 minus 1, that is 15. So this will be your minus 32768. So I have not provided the minus sign here. So if you observe and put the minus sign here, then you will get the minimum negative value, right? So this is the minimum value that we can store in short int, which is signed type. And if you want to calculate the maximum, then for that we have the formula. So this is your minimum value for a signed data type, right? That is your minus 2 to the power n minus 1. So if you want to calculate the maximum value, then the formula is, so if you want to calculate maximum value, then the formula is 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So if I calculate it again, so for short int, right? So for short int, if you calculate again, this will be a 2 to the power 16 minus 1, that is 15, minus 1. So if you calculate, you will get positive 32767. So if you observe the chart here, that is your positive 32767. So this is for your signed. Now how can we calculate for unsigned? So in case of unsigned data type, the minimum value is 0, right? Either it is short or int or long. So the minimum value is 0. Then the question is, how can we calculate the maximum value? So if you observe here, this, if this entire is your n, then this strip is divided into two parts, that is n by 2. So if your capacity is 2 to the power n, right? If your capacity to store the data is 2 to the power n, and if you divide this 2 to the power n by 2, then what happens? Here the power of 2 is 2 to the power 1, and by the law of exponent, it will be 2 to the power this n minus 1. So that is why when you are having signed data type, the entire memory area is getting divided into two parts. So as a result, this n minus 1 is involved here, right? But in case of signed, what happens? Let us see. Unsigned, right? In case of your unsigned data types, what is going to happen? The minimum value is going to be 0 and the max value is going to be 2 to the power n. 2 to the power n minus 1. Why this minus 1 is required? Because one of the digit is reserved as 0. Similarly, here also, if you see this maximum value, 2 to the power n minus 1 will give you the exact value of maximum positive number, but we need to subtract this 1 because it is reserved for your digit 0, right? So let us see that can we exactly calculate the value using these concepts. So let's proceed ahead, right? If you observe carefully, right, so just pay attention to this part now. If you want to calculate a power b, then in our C++ language we have something called a mathematical function called pow, p-o-w. So this is used to calculate power. So if you pass a comma b, this will calculate a to the power b and return you the answer, right? That means if I want to calculate 2 to the power n, then how can we calculate in our C++ language? I can use the function pow, and here first of all I will pass 2. So this is the base, and we need to pass the n, this is your exponent, right? So in order to perform this kind of calculation, we need a header file called cmath. So this contains the necessary library functions in order to perform mathematical calculations, right? So let us try to calculate the minimum value for integer, and rest of the other data types you can do it by yourself. So let's see how can we do this. So cout minimum value of int of signed of your signed int, right? So this is a normal int actually. So how can we calculate this one? So let me typecast the value first of all, because whatever value this pow function returns is actually floating point type, so it must be converted into int in order to print it properly on the screen, right? So in order to calculate the minimum value, we need to use this formula, that is minus. Now how to calculate 2 to the power n minus 1? We will use the mathematical function pow, 2 to the power, so n minus 1. So this is your minimum value followed by new line. So since these are not the part of your executable code, so I need to just comment it out, right? So let me save it and let's compile it. So if I compile it, okay, so it is throwing an error. Okay, so this n is actually the number of bits. So let us calculate the number of bits for this particular variable n2, right? So in order to do that, I will take int variable, and this n represents the number of bits. So in order to calculate the number of bits, I will use size of operator and pass n2. So this will return the total number of bytes. Now with each byte, I need to multiply 8, right? So this will give me the total number of bits, right? So if you want to see the number of the size of int data type in bits, so size of int data type in bits. So if you want to see in bits, then we can print out the value of n followed by new line. So let us compile it again and run it. So if you see, the total number, the total size of int data type in bits is your 32, and the minimum value that can be stored by your normal int is your -21474836648, right? So if you compare with this table, right, so if you just take your output and compare with this, right, so you can see here for signed int the minimum value is -21474836648, and our program also gave the same output. That means whatever this table is representing, it is the value for your signed int data type for your 64-bit compiler. So since I am also using 64-bit compiler, so my answer is same. But if you are using some different size of compiler, then you might get a different answer. So you can see clearly that how can we calculate the minimum value. In the same way, if you want to calculate the maximum value, then we have to use this formula, right? So just we'll take this data as it is and subtract 1 from it. So in order to calculate the max value for signed int data type, sorry, this should be, the spelling should be S-I-G-N-D, right? Signed. S-I-G-N-D, signed, right? So for this, I will just remove this minus sign, and from this entire, whatever it calculates, I have to subtract 1 from this in order to get the max value. So let me save it and let me compile it again. And after the compilation, if I run it, so if you observe carefully now, so the size remains the same, that is 32, and the max value is 21474836647. So you see here 48 was there, and here it is 47. So this is the max value. Now this is when your entire memory that is allocated for your int is divided into two parts. So why it is divided into two parts? Because half of the data will be reserved for representing negative values, and half of the data will be represented for representing positive values. Now what about this unsigned values, right? So let's comment out these lines and let us see how can we calculate the unsigned max and min. So for min I don't have to say, let's see for max, because min is already 0, so we don't need to calculate, we need to calculate this. So if you just take this one of the line and paste it here, right? And since I need to calculate just 2 power for max value, 2 power n, and I have to just subtract it from 1. So I'll just remove this part, and if I compile it now, so this is now unsigned actually, right? So I have to write here unsigned. So the max value of unsigned, so let me recompile it again. So if you observe carefully, after recompilation, if I run it, then you can see, okay, something is going wrong. So let me save the file, and if I recompile it again, let's say, okay, so see here, what is the problem here? It is giving negative value because I told you that by default it is signed. So for making it unsigned, we have to use the keyword here, unsigned, right? So this is important, don't miss out this word, that's why we got the wrong answer here, right? So if I recompile it again and run it, so what is going wrong here? Unsigned int n2. Okay, so what is going wrong here? 2 power n minus 1. So 2 power n minus 1. So the max value should be, the number of bits is 2 power 32. So 2 power 32, this is 2 power 32 minus 1. So it must give the proper answer. Okay, so this is, so in here also it is int type. So it is actually considering it as unsigned int. So here also I need to, so since only int is written, it is considering. So whatever value this is generating, it is considering this data as signed actually. So we need to convert into unsigned. So I have to write here unsigned. So if I compile it, so after saving, if I compile it again and if I run it, so I will get the maximum value for long data type. Sorry, maximum value for the unsigned int data type, right? So if you observe this chart, this is unsigned value, unsigned int, and the minimum values is 0 and the max value is your, if you compare with our output that we got right now, so if you observe here, it is 42949672295. So here also 42949672295. So exact number we are having, right? So we did some mistakes here. So from this mistakes, you should also learn that whenever you are dealing with unsigned, just make sure that you are using the keyword unsigned. So implicitly it is signed, but if you want to use only positive numbers, then explicitly you need to mention the keyword unsigned. So I hope that you can calculate the range of other data types as well. So now let's look into character data type, right? So in order to define character variable, we need to use the keyword char followed by the variable name semicolon. So this defines the ch variable as character data type, right? So in order to initialize this, we can use assignment operator and we can assign any character. So this statement is not completely valid because characters in C++ is represented within single quote. Now since our machine cannot understand this kind of representation, so that's why for each and every character that you see, so every character internally is represented by a numeric value, and these numerical values for every character is assigned by something called a coding encoding scheme, that is your ASCII. So this is your American Standard Code for Information Interchange. That means this is just a table where you can get all the numeric values for your particular character. So either it is your Greek alphabet or English alphabet or any kind of character it is, for every character that you want to represent in your computer system has a numeric value that is assigned by your ASCII, that is your American Standard Code for Information Interchange. For large set of character, we have also other encoding scheme such as Unicode. So let us not go so much deep inside this. So knowing some ASCII values is enough. Like if you see capital letter A, internally it is represented as the number 65. For capital B, the representation is 66. For C, 67, and so on. These are for your capital letters. If you want to represent your small letter A, so small letter A is represented by the number 97, for B, 98, and so on. So these are the ASCII values, right, for your every character that you can think about. So this is just an encoding scheme which has assigned some numeric value with each and every character, right? Now let us see how many number of bytes our character data types occupies, right? So the size of char data type in bytes. So let us see how many number of bytes does it occupies in my 64-bit GCC compiler, right? So size of the variable ch, right, followed by new line. So if I just compile my code and run it, so it gives the output 1. That means typically in a 64-bit compiler, the character data type occupies 1 byte, right? That means 8 bits of information can be represented by the help of your character data type. So it just occupies 1 byte of memory, that's it. Now if I'm interested in seeing that, if I want to write a program to, in order to see that for a particular character, what is the ASCII value of that character, right? So I'm interested in seeing, so I am saying that I will not believe in these things, right? Or even you might not believe in these things, right? So let us write a program and let's execute and see that how it is working. So if I write here cout and ch, the character followed by a new line, so let us see what happens. So if I compile my code and run it, it simply prints A. What if I want to print the value of character? Sorry, character value is already printed. What if I want to print the ASCII value of the character? So in order to do that, here ch prints the exact character. Now if you want to convert this character into ASCII value, so you just need to provide the typecast, right? So if I put int within the parenthesis, this is called typecasting. That means converting one data type to another data type is called your typecasting. So this is the syntax for your typecasting, right? So if I compile my code again and if I execute it, so you can see the ASCII value of capital letter is 65. So as you can see very clearly on the screen, right here. Now if I write here, let's say small letter A, right? And if I just compile it and run it again, then it gives the value 97. So as I've told you, it is 97, right? Now let us say that you want to take user input. So let's say character ch as it is, and I want to take the input from the user. So I can write here c in ch. So the program will be waiting for us to give some input. So let me compile it and run it. So let's say for the character 1, so 1 is a character. When you will insert 1 inside this variable ch, it will go as a character, not as a numeric value. So if I press enter, then you see it prints 49. If I run it again and if I hit the number 0, so this is numeric 0, but since it is going inside the character variable, so it is your actually a character. So if I hit enter, so it gives 48. So 48 is the ASCII value of this character 0. Similarly, 49 is the ASCII value of 1, and so on, right? So this was all about your characters. So now let's look at Boolean data type. So for that we are having the keyword bool. So bool is the keyword for Boolean. So let me take the variable name, let's say f. So this particular data type can take one of the two values, either true or false. So if I write f equals to true, so any non-zero value in C++ is known as true, and any value which is zero, that is known as false. So either you can assign false to the variable or true. So now let us print out the value of this and let's see what does it prints. Cout value of f followed by the new line, semicolon. So let me compile the code and execute it. So if I compile it and execute it, so it prints 1. That means standard value of true in C++ is 1. So if I write f equals to, let's say 67, it's a numeric value. So let me compile it and run it. So it prints 1. That means any non-zero value, even if I put minus 167 and save and compile it again, and if I just run it, so again it prints 1. That means any non-zero value is represented as 1. So internally, if I am writing here, let's say true, internally it is represented as 1. If I write false, internally it is represented as 0. So if I compile it and run it again, so it prints 0, right? So anything which is false, it will print 0, and anything which is true, it will print 1. So let me write a condition here. First of all, if I write here, let's say 1 greater than 2, we know very well that 1 is not greater than 2. So let us see that what value this f holds. So if I just compile my program again and if I run it, so it is giving 0. That means this statement is false. Now if I write here 11 greater than 2, is it true? If it is true, then it should print 1 on the screen, right? So let me compile it and let me run it. So it prints 1. That means if any of the expression evaluates to true, then it will be represented as 1 internally, and if any of the expression is evaluated as 0, then it is if it is evaluated as false, then it is represented as 0 internally, right? So this was all about your bool data type. And if you want to see that what is the size of bool data type, so you can just print size of bool, right? End L. So let me comment out this line. So if I compile and run it again, so it again takes 1 byte. That means the minimum size of your bool data type is your 1 byte in a typical 64-bit compiler. So my compiler is actually 64-bit compiler. So all the data type ranges and values that you are seeing is for 64-bit compiler. It might happen that you might get a different answer in your compiler because it might be 32-bit or 16-bit compiler. So it depends actually on the compiler and the system. So what kind of ranges and what kind of sizes you are getting, that is completely your compiler and machine dependent, right? So this was all about your bool data type. Now the next we will look at floating point data type, right? So here one important point is that all floating point numbers are actually signed, right? And the floating point numbers are stored in computers using IEEE standard, right? So C++ provides 3 different keywords in order to represent floating point numbers, right? So first is your float, which can store smaller precision of values. Then we have double, which can store slightly larger precision of values. And then the largest numbers that we can deal in C++ for mathematical computation is your long double, right? So this is the figure which depicts the size. So this is the size of the float, double and long double. So let's see in our code that what is the size and ranges, right? So you can see that these are the examples of your float and these are the examples of your double and long double. So let's write some code. So if you want to represent float, right, so I can write here float keyword, and then I can write n1, let's say, and I can store any number, let's say 12 point, any number like this, semicolon. And if I write here f, it means that it is a float data type. This number is suitable for float data type. Then we can have double for greater precision, right? So if you want more precision, then we are using something called double, right? So this is 213 point. See, many numbers are there, right? And if you want even more precision, better precision, then we can use something called long double data type, let's say n3. So this can hold even larger values, right? So if you want to see what are the sizes, then we can print out the sizes using the size of operator. So this is your size of float in bytes, right? So by now you might have become familiar with how to use the size of operator, right? So size of n1. Similarly, we can print for n2 and n3. So this is for your n2 and this for your n3. So here size of double and here size of, let's say, long double in bytes. So whatever will be printed on the screen, that will be in bytes, right? So let us recompile our program and let's run it. So if I run it, you can see the size of float is 4 bytes, double 8 bytes, and the long double is 16 bytes. So you can understand it is a very large number, right? So within 16 bytes, with the help of 16 bytes, we can represent really large numbers for mathematical computations, right? So these are some examples that I have already told you. So the default size of floating point literal is double. So in order to mark the numbers as float, we need to provide this suffix as f. So that's why I have written f here, so that exactly it is float. If you don't write f here, then this number internally will be treated as double. Because we are putting the value of this inside float, so it is better practice to mention the suffix f in order to represent it float, right? So these were the examples, and if you remember, for your float data type, we have already written a program, right, to calculate the area and circumference of a circle. So by that you should be familiar that how can we write mathematical programs with the help of this. So whenever you are supposed to deal with very large numbers and you want a very greater precision, then you should always go for long double, right? So these were the basic primitive data types that we'll be using in our programs. So there are some other data types as well. Those can be your compound data type. So there is one data type that is your void actually. So void is the data type which is specially used with functions. So in the upcoming lesson, when we will talk about function, so there we will talk about void in more detail. So if I write void keyword and some variable name, let's say vn, and if I try to compile it, let's see what happens. So if I compile it, so it gives an error. So it says that the variable or field vn declared void. That means if you cannot declare your variable having the data type void. Why? Because it cannot store any data, right? That's why it is called your valueless data type. So let's try to write a statement. If I write here, let's say something size of void, then what will happen? Followed by a new line. So let's see what happens. So if I compile my code, so it gives an warning. It is giving a warning, right? So it is saying that invalid application of size of, that means in size of you must not put void. But still, let us see that what is the output of this, right? It is pretty interesting. So it is giving 1. So although I am saying that it is what is called your valueless type, but how it is possible that it can occupy 1 byte in memory, right? So you think about it. So when we will go to the upcoming lesson for functions, so there I will discuss about these things, right? So I hope the data type section is clear. The video is really long, I can understand that. So you need to watch this again and again to make the concept of data type clear. So because the concept was really big, that's why the length of the video also went bigger. But if you watch this video, then the things will become very clear to you. Hope you understand everything. So I'll try to cover the overflow of data in some other video. So thank you for watching.